think of when you hear the word anarchism? Do you picture a world that's fallen into disorder and chaos, where the law has been done away with and riots, violence, and murder have just become a part of everyday life? Where young people decide to rebel against the state for no other reason than their teens who were rebellious and are a part of a movement that's immature in its understanding of the world? Does it inspire visions of masked vigilantes like the ones from V for Vendetta, all banding together to form a black legion of revolutionaries, ready to burn down any and all who stand in their way? Or do you see something that more resembles the post-apocalyptic wastelands of Mad Max, where war boys race towards Valhalla, screaming,
Witness!
While venturing through vast barren deserts on vehicles outfitted with spikes, axes, flamethrowers, and anything else that could be used to maim, debilitate, and kill whomever they please? It's all pretty outlandish, but there's a common belief that to be an anarchist is to be a terrorist and reject all forms of organization, cooperation, aid, safety, stability. Look at how both mainstream and conservative media tend to paint Antifa, which isn't made up of just anarchists, but is a movement of anti-fascist advocates and not a true organization. Newscasters warn of masked thugs whose sole mission is to destroy property, burn cop cars, which is a lovely sight, as well as intimidate and attack poor little innocent alt-riders and white supremacists who just want to use their constitutional rights of free speech and freedom of assembly to promote their totally innocent, definitely patriotic ideals, which tend to include eugenics and the genocide of non-whites, the idea that immigrants are threatening to dilute the ethnic makeup of America and wipe the white race from existence, the need to protect their European lineage. Y'all's families have probably been here for around 200 years at this point. Y'all are American, for Christ's sake! The use of scientific racism to say that Black Americans are just genetically predisposed to violent behavior, threatening to kill any brown people they come across, like members of the Proud Boys have done here in Portland. I could go on all day. Trust me. Anyways, when the average person hears someone mention anarchism, their mind will likely picture one of the aforementioned stereotypes. But even if those stories are rooted in real sociopolitical theory, they're still fiction and obviously could never arise in our reality. But the American media has for decades upon decades now taken these stories, as well as real-life militant revolutionary anarchist groups, pointed the finger at them and claims that there's some force of societal destruction that must be stopped. They claim that they will plunge the world into anarchy. And this is where we have to outline the difference between anarchy and anarchism, slight as it may be. Anarchy, which means without ruler, refers to a state of affairs in which, if there are no police, no lawmakers, no ruling body, and no authority whatsoever, it's every person for themselves. Anarchism, on the other hand, is a social movement that seeks liberation from oppressive systems of control, including but not limited to the state, capitalism, sexism, racism, ableism, and religion. Yes, I got the definition from the anarchism thread on Reddit. Shut up! Anarchy itself isn't interconnected with anarchism, and the two can exist separately from one another. For example, law and order tends to break down when a hurricane or natural disaster strikes and does tremendous damage, much like Hurricane Katrina, as well as the inaction of the George W. Bush administration did to New Orleans back in 2005. Louisiana fell into a state of anarchy because whatever order existed before was drowned by the storm surge. So, anarchy can often be seen as the natural result of disasters, war, and other external forces, whereas anarchism is an organized collective of people who share a similar ideology, the abolishment of all hierarchies due to their oppressive nature, and the liberation of those of us who, without our consent, have been held down, abused, stolen from, and kicked aside by those in power. And what I want to do today is discuss what anarchism is and isn't, while talking about what the founding philosophers behind the anarchist ideology believe needed to be its guiding principles. So, first things first, let's answer an incredibly important question. What is anarchism? I won't go into all the various schools of thought that share the anarchist name because there is not enough time in one video to do so, but I'll instead go into the overarching principles that tie all of them together. You could sum it up simply as a rejection of coercive government and everything that comes along with it, but that would be a bit reductionist. If you're wanting to help people gain a broader understanding of every facet of anarchist ideology. If we widen the scope just a bit, we'll see that many proponents of anarchism advocate for the total elimination of class, racial or gender-based inequalities, and the toppling of any hierarchical structures that press themselves down upon the masses in order to control and maintain their power and place in society, as well as the trajectory of their lives. Pierre Joseph Proudhon, referred to by some as the father of anarchism and the first person to refer to himself as an anarchist, said in 1923 that to be governed is to be watched, inspected, spied upon, directed, law-driven, numbered, regulated, enrolled, indoctrinated, preached at, controlled, checked, estimated, valued, censured, commanded by creatures who have neither the right nor the wisdom nor the virtue to do so, and that the great are only great because we are on our knees. And though he's partly responsible for kickstarting what we now know as the modern anarchist movement, and his writings are still a core part of most anarchist schools of thought, he was a known anti-Semite, and considered publishing an article in 1847 that would have stated, "The Jew is the enemy of the human race. This race must be sent back to Asia or exterminated." He was also widely criticized for his sexist beliefs and sparked a wave of backlash after saying, "A woman does not at all hate being used with violence, indeed even being violated, and that to a woman, a man is a father, a chief, above all, a master." Which is funny because no gods, no masters. You know. Other anarchists of the time and in later years told him to denounce his words or stop calling himself an anarchist, since his words contradicted the founding principles of the movement. And this really pinpoints why I think it's necessary for us to take inspiration from his writings while actively denouncing his bigotry that echoes the words of white supremacists, incels, and all those who are situated within or somewhere around the alt-right. We need a 21st century anarchism that comes up with new solutions to modern problems while holding on to the things that built the foundation that we now stand upon and separating theory from outdated ideals. Having said all of this, however, just focusing on one philosopher's work isn't nearly enough to give you a good understanding of any particular field, subject, ideology, what have you. Mikhail Bakunin, one of my personal favorite writers, was not just the founder of collectivist anarchism, which advocates for the abolition of both the state and private property, and the collective ownership of both by producers and workers, a prestigious activist and critic of Marxism, but he was also highly critical of the church and saw it, like I do, as a method of controlling and indoctrinating millions. One of his most famous takedowns of evangelism was his quote, "If God really existed, it would be necessary to abolish him," and it should be added that in general it is the character of every metaphysical and theological argument to seek to explain one absurdity by another, which is something that prominent atheist writer and speaker Christopher Hitchens, as well as many involved in the modern atheist community, talk about whenever they view God as a sort of celestial dictator. Bakunin also pointed out something that I've noticed, that Satan is the true hero of the Bible. He said, "But here steps in Satan, the eternal rebel, the first free thinker and emancipator of worlds. He makes man ashamed of his bestial ignorance and obedience. He emancipates him, stamps upon his brow the seal of liberty and humanity, and urging him to disobey and eat the fruit of knowledge." And in his unfinished pamphlet, God and the State, he puts the final nail in the cross by saying, "The idea of God implies the abdication of human reason and justice. It is the most decisive negation of human liberty and necessarily ends in the enslavement of mankind in both theory and practice." Ooh, those are some spicy truth bombs. Not every anarchist sees religion in this way, but I and many, many others see it as an oppressive hierarchy, an extension of the state, and a parasitic corruptor of culture and government that will present a danger to human rights as long as it is allowed to exist. The third philosopher whom I believe completes the holy trinity of influential anarchist philosophers, or at least the ones anyone curious about anarchism should read up on, is Peter Kropotkin. Kropotkin was quite the Renaissance man, and the scope of his career includes work as an activist, writer, revolutionary, scientist, economist, sociologist, historian, essayist, researcher, political scientist, biologist, we could keep going all day, geographer, and philosopher who advocated for anarcho-communism, the school of thought that I personally follow. In some of his most well-known works, which include Mutual Aid, which I dug into in the first part of my COVID series, The Conquest of Bread, and Modern Science and Anarchy. You should read all of these, by the way. They are fantastic. He critiqued the ways in which capitalism creates poverty, artificial scarcity, and hierarchies of privilege, talked about the need for mutual aid and the resistance to any natural conditions that are unfavorable to our survival, and the importance of building a country that is fully self-sufficient. Kropotkin was highly critical of wage slavery and the wealth gap, saying poverty, the existence of the poor was the first cause of riches, examined the ways in which laws written by the powerful only exist to serve the powerful by saying, the law has no claim to human respect, it has no civilizing mission, its only purpose is to protect exploitation. And he spoke on the genesis of revolutionary action by saying, and this one in particular caught my attention, revolutions, we must remember, are always made by minorities. The one quote I always think of whenever I think of Kropotkin, as well as what I see as a succinct summary of anarchism as a whole, is. Anarchy, whenever it works to destroy authority in all its aspects, when it demands the abrogation of laws and the abolition of the mechanism that serves to impose them, when it refuses all hierarchical organization and preaches free agreements, at the same time strives to maintain and enlarge the precious kernel of social customs without which no human or animal society can exist. Only instead of demanding that these social customs should be maintained through the authority of a few, it demands it from the continued action of all. So, taking everything that we've now discussed about Proudhon, Bakunin, and Kropotkin, we can sum up the primary tenets of anarchism as a rejection of all forms of oppression and hierarchy, a need for mutual aid, cooperation, and solidarity amongst the proletariat and all marginalized communities, and the abolition of the state and creation of a decentralized societal structure in which everyone is given equal opportunity to life, health, happiness, pursuits, and control over their destiny. Now that we have effectively defined what anarchism is, what its principles are, and how I think in 2020 we should approach and talk about it, let's take a look at the other side of the coin. What is anarchism not? It is not terrorism. Even though the textbook definition of terrorism is the unlawful use of violence and intimidation, especially against civilians in the pursuit of political aims, I think there needs to be a deeper understanding of why these acts are being committed, whether they're merely to terrorize others or to fight for a cause to liberate people. There's a well-known term within the anarchist community that has been weaponized against it and used to paint it with a broad, violent brush, the propaganda of the deed. What this refers to is acts of violence perpetrated by proponents of insurrectionary anarchism in the late 19th and early 20th century, including bombings and assassinations aimed at the ruling class, but also had non-violent applications. These deeds were intended to ignite the spirit of revolt in the people by demonstrating that the state was not omnipotent and by offering hope to the downtrodden and also to expand support for anarchist movements as the state grew more repressive in its response. Such events include perhaps the most notable, the Haymarket Affair, a mass protest which occurred in Chicago on May 3rd, 1886, in which thousands of workers participating in a labor demonstration to fight for an 8-hour workday clashed with police led by the chant, "A pound of dynamite is better than a bushel of bullets. Police and militia, the bloodhounds of capitalism, are ready to murder." Uttered by August Spies, the editor of the anarchist daily, Die Arbeiter Zeitung. As the crowds were dispersed, someone threw dynamite into the ranks of police, killing one officer. As a result, a grand jury sentenced 8 organizers to death, one being Spies himself. His last words remain a clarion call to anarchists and unionizers alike. The day will come when our silence will be more powerful than the voices that you are throttling today. This event is the origin of the International Workers' Day, or May Day, and led to a strengthening amongst labor organizers against the capitalist class. Fear-mongering and anti-union propaganda were also escalated in the aftermath, causing many to see the anarchists involved as violent terrorists. But Beverly Gage, a professor of U.S. history at Yale University, said regarding these revolutionaries as well as the propaganda of the deed, among anarchism's founding premises was the idea that a capitalist society was a place of constant violence. Every law, every church, every paycheck was based on force. In such a world, to do nothing, to stand idly by while millions suffered, was itself to commit an act of violence. The question was not whether violence per se might be justified, but exactly how violence might be maximally effective for, in the words of German-American anarchist newspaper and editor and orator Johann Most, the originator of the term, annihilating the beast of property that makes mankind miserable and gains in cruelty and voracity with the progress of our so-called civilization. These acts of resistance and violence were not committed by the vast majority of anarchists for the sole reason of causing violence, but as a way to effectively resist the power of the state. Italian anarchist Errico Malatesta, a critic of the term propaganda of the deed, effectively summed up why it's necessary to approach revolutionary acts with the right mindset. Violence or physical force used to another's hurt, which is the most brutal form of struggle between men can assume, is eminently corrupting. It tends, by its very nature, to suffocate the best sentiments of man, and to develop all the antisocial qualities, ferocity, hatred, revenge, the spirit of domination and tyranny, contempt of the weak, servility towards the strong. And later on said, as anarchists, we cannot and we do not desire to employ violence, except in the defense of ourselves and others against oppression, but we claim this right of defense, entire, real, and efficacious. That is, we wish to be able to go behind the material instrument which wounds us, and to attack the hand which wields the instrument, and the head which directs it. As an anarchist myself, I would never dream of harming another individual. I believe in fighting for a world that cares for every single citizen, and does away with anything that would seek to subjugate or discriminate against someone for circumstances that are completely outside of their control. But I also recognize that oppression itself is a form of violence, and our capitalist American society is a coercive force that seeks to press its boot against our necks and demand that we pay up and fall in line or be suffocated. It strips citizens of all their autonomy and reduces their inherent meaning down to a speck the size of a space rock floating past Jupiter. Every big boss has a fairly obvious weak point, and even if we can't yet get a direct hit on said weak point, we can still work towards it little by little through local action and not just words, because we cannot just sit here and spin our wheels. That's built up to a larger scale, and an infiltration into every corner of state and federal governments will give us the wedge needed to split the entire system open and then tear it to pieces. And speaking of organization, anarchism is neither chaos nor a lack of organization. We recognize not only the dangers that a breakdown in societal order would pose to the populace, but also the fact that organizational structures are not inherently bad. If we are to successfully overthrow the entire capitalist structure of America, as well as the oppressors who built and maintained it, we would not ourselves become oppressors in the process. When we talk about the need for organizing and building movements of working class people and every single soul who, whether they realize it or not, have been kept from reaching the full potential of their lives, this is the type of organization we pride ourselves on and actively fight for. Anarchism, to me, is the great equalizer. It's everyone looking out for one another, and it collapses all of the arbitrary barriers that prevented everyday people from understanding why they've been separated, as well as the power of solidarity. General strikes, rent strikes, debt strikes, job strikes, unionizing, any and all forms of mass protests, all of these are forms of organization which are in accordance with the anarchist principles of individual freedom and social justice, and bring order through the abolition of a disordered system. Capitalism itself has caused disorganization and chaos within society and around the world through class warfare, racist, classist, and ableist propaganda, segmentation of different communities, and the prioritizing of more privileged people at the top and less privileged people at the bottom. We're kept at war with one another and threatened with harm should we ever dare to rise up and fight back, and told that this disorder is normal, that disorder is order, while true order is disorder. Pull the American flag and the Benjamins off of your eyes, and you'll see the great switcheroo that's been pulled on you. The same forces behind union busting, the hunting down of anarchist activists, and the shutting down of or antagonism towards leftist movements and protests, again, see Antifa, have to scare you away from seeing the truth. Coercion, intimidation, manipulation, and literal threats have become the name of the game because, to date in this country, they've worked. In the age of information, though, they can only maintain the illusion for so long. As much destruction and death has already been caused by the American imperialist regime, they will happily cause even more destabilization at home and around the world in a last-ditch effort to stop the pillars of sand underneath them from dissolving. But dissolve they will. It is inevitable that a system based on consumption will eventually consume itself, and a state of disorder, anarchy, will over time change to a state of order, the state of anarchism. So, to sum it up, we are not terrorists. We do not seek to throw the world into lawlessness or post-apocalyptic madness, but goddamn, do some anarchists have some of the coolest post-apocalyptic outfits. I mean, look at them. Okay, I'm getting sidetracked. Why is all of this important? If you're someone who isn't familiar with anarchism or even leftism in general, why on earth would you have even a passing interest in it? Because the principles of anarchism are a hell of a lot more relatable than you think. I, as well as numerous friends of mine, have had conversations with those from an older generation or more conservative mindset, in which we described our beliefs, what we want to see happen in society, how we think people should be treated, the opportunities that everyone should have, etc. And those older and/or conservative people agreed with us. It made perfect sense to them. Which, of course, shows plain as day that not one single smidge of the propaganda perpetuated against our movement has any substance to it. Deep down, every single one of us understands the need for unity and the dangers that coercive forces pose to our well-being as well as our foothold in society. All we have to do is connect the dots from their experiences to anarchism itself, and I guarantee you'd have plenty of holy shit reactions from those that you are educating. The bridge that will lead us from class warfare to class solidarity is stronger than you think, and that strength will come from you, your voice, your advocacy, your action, and your willingness to be a conduit of information and enlightenment, as well as a lightning rod that draws others in and lights a spark inside of them. A spark that energizes them to fight for true equality, true freedom for all, a world in which every life is given the same opportunity and every personal pursuit, creative or otherwise, is given the same nurturing support, and a society in which not a single solitary soul would ever have to worry about homelessness, poverty, having to struggle on their own with no one to help, being oppressed for who you are. It's not a utopia. It's what I think of when I hear the word anarchism.